Hallelujah. Good morning, my brothers and sisters. I want to welcome you to the house of the Lord this morning. I want to invite you at this time to stand in the sanctuary. Let us make our hearts ready before the Lord. This is the day that the Lord had made. We do rejoice and are glad in it. I want to welcome those who are joining us online this morning, Facebook and YouTube. I want to welcome those who are visiting for the first time, in-house and online. God bless you. God bless you. We have been going through our weekends of meetings under the theme, I Choose. I hope you have been richly blessed so far. We continue this morning under the same theme, and we continue tonight under the same theme, I Choose. Let us just raise our hands this morning as we enter into his gates with thanksgiving. As we enter into his courts, we offer praise unto the Lord our God. We say, who is like you, O God? Awesome and incredible. We thank him for his grace and his mercy. As we stand to worship this morning, I want to invite the praise team to come and do our opening hymn. And immediately after the praise team come and do that hymn, our deacon, Lancelot Riley, will be coming to us with our opening prayer. God bless you as we worship today in the beauty of holiness.
Do you believe that God is good? Is your desire to worship God this morning? To honor God with your praises this morning? We want to give him praise with all we have. So if you know this song, you can sing it with us. This is my desire. Oh,
Hallelujah. Praise be to God. Let us pray. Father God, we lift up praise unto your name because we have come to know who you are. You are a take charge God, a God who is all powerful, one that there is nothing impossible for you to achieve. And so, Lord God, we ask at this moment that you take over this service. Take over and make sure, Lord God, that whatever happened today happened according to your will, according to your way. And those who are about to take part in this service, let your spirit flow through them, Father God. Those who is about to bring the word, Lord God, that the word may come forth with like a mighty force, like a mighty rushing wind, clearing the way and preparing our heart, Lord God, to receive you in a special way. Father God, we just give you praise because we know, Lord God, that you're a God of love. You're a God that loves us even when nobody else loves us. You're a God who cares for us even when everybody abandons us, Lord God. And even when we go through our struggles, Lord God, when we have our problem, Lord God, you are dear for us. And so we sing your praise continuously. And if people think we are strange, that we praise you even when we are going through so many difficulties, then we just continue to praise you because they don't know the type of relationship that we have with you. A relationship that has come to show us that you will never abandon us, that you will always be there for us. And so we continue to sing your praise, Father God. And so, Lord God, we just ask that you bless the rest of the service, even the service to come this evening, and that whatever be done, done according to your will, as we ask in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are in times of evangelistical meetings, you know. So we are together again, praising God, giving God thanks for his abundant mercies and grace. Amen. You came to praise the Lord this morning. You came to give back to the Lord what is due unto him. Come on now, somebody. Somebody give God a praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We magnify you, Lord. We adore you, our King. We hail your high majesty. If you have your Bibles this morning, can we stand in the house of the Lord and we turn to Matthew chapter 6? We'll be reading from verses 24 to 34. And coming to read for us this morning is Joshua Bailey. Immediately after the scripture reading, we will have a testimony by our counselor, Clifford Gray. Hallelujah. Amen.
Good morning, church. Scripture reading is taken from Matthew chapter 6, verses 24 to 34. And it reads, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. It is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. And ye not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, I God, so clothe the grass of the field, which to this day, and which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we eat, or what shall we drink? Or wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Here endeth a portion of the reading of God's holy word. We honor it by saying, Amen.
Hallelujah. Take no thought for tomorrow. Amen. Tomorrow takes thought for itself. Deacon Gray will be coming to us at this time to share a testimony.
Hallelujah. 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 Could we all just lift our hands unto the Holy One this morning? It's not by might nor by power, but by the Spirit of the Lord. I know, hallelujah, the theme is that I choose. Amen. And it's not me of myself who have chosen to be in this presence hour. It is Christ who has chosen me. Amen. I know he is a savior. And because he saved me with his saving grace, hallelujah, I can stand before you this morning to say that many toils, you know, and sneers, but I can tell us, brethren, that Jesus come through for me. Amen. And this morning, I am rejoicing in this full and free salvation, brethren. And when I say I'm rejoicing, not because, you see, there are things that are going around, happening each hour, each minute, each day, and year, and week in our lives. But I can say, where God has taken me from, and where he has placed me this morning, Sister Stephen Dominic, I can tell you that God is good. God is wonderful. God, listen to me. He might be a God that does not work in our time, but he's working on his time. Bless the name of Jesus. Because, you know, I can look back into the Bible where God have done things for those that was before us. Like David, Almighty. When David was with those sheep going through those valleys and shadows of death, taking care of them. Come on. And when God looked down and know the heart of David about those sheep that he's taking care of, God looked within his own will and works of mankind and say, there is a heart that is within you that can make you more than what you are today. Come on, church. And God has pulled David away. So I'm saying that he has pulled me out of darkness and he has placed me into his marvelous light. Come on. Many might not see all this anointing that flows as the oil that when Samuel have lived from the house where he was and went to Jesse's house. But God came through for me. Bless the name of Jesus. I said God came through for me. Because right up at Brownstone, at the corner where you turn through that little, between the two shop to go to my house, that's where I was standing when I heard a voice speak to me
and says to me, I need you all to survey the churches in Ewarton and tell me which one you have been chosen to attend and come to me. And when I begin to name the churches, I name both 5 going to 6. And all when I naming the church, I heard no, no, no. I named them down to Church of Christ out here, so. And I heard no, I stopped. And brethren, in all my stopping, I did not say it's nothing more. Sister Stevenson can bear me witness because she was the one who says to me, come, there is a street meeting out there, and it's my parish, you know, who having that meeting there, which was Pastor Morgan. May his soul rest in peace. And brethren, when I walked out with her, she went and stand very close to where the preacher was at. And I was standing at the corner of the shop, going into my lane. And that's where I went. I never moved from there until the service over. And when it ended, I turned to Sister Stephen after she walked away and come. I said, my sister, let me tell you something. Whenever time you are ready to go and visit the church, I will be there with you. But I'm not going to take the main road. I'm going to take you through the gully. 1 year and 5 months we have been going through that gully before I gave my life to the Lord. And today I know that it is not an easy road. Listen to me. When I look into the life of salvation, if God did not do something which I could not pay for, church, I wouldn't be alive today. And I'm still going through, which I just zip my mouth. I said, the buckle is not for gray. The buckle is for the Lord. I will be persecuted for his righteousness' sake. The Bible said, men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you for his righteousness' sake. Come on. He also said it all. I came unto my own, and my own received me not. I was hungry, they never feed me. I was thirsty, they never gave me water to drink. If I were to depend upon man on earth, I would be a loser. But this morning, the winner is Jesus Christ. Brethren, please just pray for me. Stay where you are in Christ. You will never lose these blessings of salvation. God bless you all.
Hallelujah. Praise God. A man who heard a call, and it took him 1 year and how many months? And 5 months to answer. I'm not too interested in the 1 year and 5 months. I'm interested in the fact that he answered. But even greater than the answer, what is interesting is the patient love of God. That God waited 1 year and 5 months to redeem him. What is also great is not the patient love of God alone, but the protective grace of God that preserved his life for that 1 year and 5 months that he did not pass out of this world in sin. What a God. How long did he wait for you? How long did he wait for me? Can I say to you this morning, he is at somebody's heart's door today. And it might be longer than 1 year and 5 months. And he's knocking. He says, I stand at the door. If you hear me, would you let me in? What a God. Some of us can't wait overnight for something to happen. But God could wait over 20 years for me, 30 years for you, 40 years for somebody else, 50. I mean, come on. Incredible. We are entering right now into a time of praise and worship. Can I invite you to stand with us as the praise team come and give to God that praise that is on our hearts? God bless you.
Shall we worship the Lord? Shall we worship the Lord? Can I get a shout of praise in the house this morning? Hallelujah. I choose Jesus this morning. Who do you choose? I choose Jesus this morning. Hallelujah. And because I choose Jesus this morning, I put him in front of everything. I put him in front of everything this morning. He's the only thing that matters in my life this morning. Hallelujah. 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 is worthy this morning. Hallelujah. He alone is worthy this morning. Hallelujah. Worship the Lord this morning.
Worship and I.
said, it is said that they are lords many and they are little G-O-D's many. I know of one that is worshipped called Haile Selassie. I know he died, but he's still in the grave. The song say, hallelujah. We, Christ Jesus, had won the victory. You see, if our Savior died and was just buried, if he never rose from the dead and ascend into heaven, he says, I go to my Father. I'm going to your Father because I have to settle the case. So when we sing hallelujah, you have won the victory. You have to understand that your salvation is dependent on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. For without resurrection, there is no hope. But praise God this morning that we are exercising resurrection power. We are living in resurrection power. And so we sing, hallelujah. You have won the victory. Oh God, many tried to fight for our savings, but they died and could not achieve it. But he did so well. He conquered death, conquered the grave. Brothers and sisters, friends, loved ones, this morning we have with us Reverend Howard Johnson. Reverend Howard Johnson hails from the Waltham Park New Testament Church. A powerful speaker, a man of word, coined with present day, what you call them now? Present day little ways of engrafting scriptures into present time reality. He's a wizard at it. He is the director of evangelism and missions. A man that has a wonderful wife. And we wait to celebrate with him many children. I want you to make the servant of the Lord this morning welcome, as he brings to us that which the Lord has laid on his heart under the theme, I Choose. Hallelujah. Make the servant of the Lord welcome this morning, Reverend Johnson.
Blessings, Reverend Bailey. Can you just put your hands above your head and give God a clap offering? Hallelujah. Put your hands above your head and give God a clap offering. He deserves it. Hallelujah. He is worthy. He has won the victory. Yeah, man, this morning when I got up, you may be seated. You know, when I was leaving the house, my wife said, make sure you have your mask. You know? And I said, yes, I have it. And she said, did you pick up your rag? And I said, yes, I have it. Yeah, man. But you know what we must make sure we have? We must make sure that we never left our prayers at home, but that we brought our worship to the sanctuary. God is good. And God has been good. I don't know what circumstances, situations, what seasons you are going through now, but God is good. Sometimes when we look in our lives, it's hard to find things to worship God about, you know? But it's when we look about who God is, we find every reason to worship, no matter the season, whether it's drought, whether it's cold, whether it's lonely season, whether it's frustration, depression season, God is in control, and that is reason to worship. I want to greet your host pastor and my very good friend and colleague, Errol Bailey, prophetically speaking. It's coming, it's coming. It's coming. I want to greet his wife, Cherie, and the children who aid in worship and ministry. Greetings in the mighty name of Jesus. I want to greet the leaders, the councilmen and women of this church and those who are members and supporters and well-wishers of this congregation. I greet you in the mighty name of Jesus. I also greet those who are viewing via social media. Welcome, welcome. Yes, the crusade is entitled I Choose, and this is the third service, and I have had the honor and privilege of watching the first two services that was led out by my former pastor and good friend, yeah man, Pastor Nigel Martin. Yeah man, it was, trust me, wonderful, powerful words, you know. And I said to Errol when we spoke after the first night that him get the ball rolling, him kick off the thing good, you know, and so we can't drop the button. Yeah man, because him start the thing for a level, you know, and so we have to, by the grace of God, allow the Spirit of God to maintain and elevate that level if he so desires. But God is in control. The text was read from Matthew 6. I'm just going to read two verses. The first verse that I'm reading is 24. It says, "No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. You will devote to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money." Then verse 33 says, "Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need." Heavenly Father, we bless your name this morning. We thank you for this time in your presence. We pray that your Spirit will move under this roof, Almighty God, and in this context and space, and that people will experience deliverance, liberty, salvation, renewal, and refreshing as your word is declared. Father, use me as a medium, a channel through which you communicate your word and will to your people. In Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, I choose to put God first. Turn to somebody else and say, I choose to put God first. Yeah, man. And if you're on social media, just type, "I choose to put God first." And if I want to render this theme in a local kind of way, a Jamaican kind of way, I would say this message is God over devil. Somebody say, God over devil. Yeah, man. Or they would have said, good over evil. And so we're saying that we put God first. Whenever someone says they are putting something first, it suggests that it is significant, that it is important, that it is priority, that it is urgent, that no other matter should be placed above it. Yeah, man, it means it come first. It means that all of our attention, our energy, our devotion is given to this. Can I say to us that as we live in this world, sometimes we don't get our priorities right. Or sometimes some things come to us so forcefully that we believe that they are priorities, that they should be at the top of our to-do list, that we should engage this first before we look at anything else. Can I say some persons have put money as a priority? That they recognize that they need money, and money is a necessity, but the value and the energy that they give to acquiring and getting more money becomes that chief thing in their life, and God becomes secondary. Others have placed pleasure at the top of their to-do list. They live life wanting to feel good. They want to be happy, and they want to have a smile all the time. And so these persons put pleasure at the top of their list. Can I say to us that when we put pleasure at the top of our list, we don't ask if the thing right or wrong. We ask if it feel good. Yeah, man, if it pleasing, if it brings satisfaction, if it gratifies a need that I have. Can I say that if we are living our lives driven by impulse, by feeling, that we worship when we feel like, that we come to church when we feel like, that we give when we feel like, that we forgive when we feel like, that if we're living life on the pleasure plane, that we are missing it. Some of us give priority to possessions. We believe that the more we acquire or the more we have, the more important we are. We believe that security and stability comes from having more things. Yeah, man, but one person aptly said, more money, more problems. Some of us believe that success should be at the top of our to-do list. That as we sojourn life, we want to be successful. And we often measure success by the amount of fame, popularity, possessions, acquisitions that we have garnered. We look at our career and our schooling, if we have doctorate, lawyerate, nurserate, and teacherette, that if we have these things, we have gotten there. Somehow we feel that if we get these stuff, we have reached. But I want to challenge us to measure success differently. Yeah. I measure success from a different space. And this is the space from which I measure success. We must start with who we are and not what we have. The world measures success by starting by looking at what you have. A scammer can be driving a BMW and them say make it. But for me, he hasn't made it. He has illegally acquired some stuff. And he might have some physical possession, but his moral, his character, his integrity, his model that he's setting, or image that he portrays is not a successful one. He just have some things, that is a man with money that. But success comes from who we are. Persons who devote themselves to money will say this, get rich or die trying. And I remember local DJ, dancehall artist Baby Sham saying, no money now make a man a suffer. And to all the country around it, I got tougher. And then him said, therefore, anywhere the money there, me I got guffer. In other words, he would compromise himself to get money. And Jesus in this text, in this sermon, say you can't serve God and money. Because if you're serving both, you're going to pick one. You know how you're going to pick one? Jesus says you're going to devote yourself to one. And you're going to despise one. And guess what? Even if in your mind you feel like you're doing 50-50, one is going to get more of your time and your energy. That is simply what Jesus is saying. You know? He must say, if you love me and you love money, at the end of the day, your actions, your choices, your moves are going to suggest where you stand. Somebody say, I choose to put God first. People will say that. And then, you know, the Bible talks about people who honor God with them lips, but their hearts are far from him. In other words, your actions should speak louder than your word. Yeah, man, you have some man who say them are thugs and gangster, but as a little shadow blow and shaking at the night, them run gone. As a little mongrel dog bark, them run gone. The other day, I start work up puppy inside pastor, and me dep on the road, I go up on a job. And when I was going on the job, I saw a young man that was walking. Him have the wickedest bad man walk me ever see. Yeah, man, the man walk bad. Or the baddest walk me ever see. I mean, I say, if the man even 10% as bad as how him walk, he must dangerous. I was just looking at it. But guess what? I don't know if him is a gangster or him is a coward. I don't know if him is a thugs or him is a chicken. But him have a walk that suggests him really bad. Him fully bad. Yeah, man, I saw him a step. And when he must step one dog, I step behind him, and him step fully bad. And me, I said, you look dangerous. And him, if me was a policeman, I'd just stop. Just search him, just because how him walk. Yeah, man. Some of us, we say, God, we come church and we put on big hat. We come church and we jump and shout. But after we leave church, God gone pan the back burner. Some of us, we put school before God. We put all type of things before God. And God is an afterthought. I want to challenge us to not only walk the walk, but talk the talk. Turn to your neighbor and say, walk the walk and talk the talk. And that's the introduction, listeners. Pray for me at the introduction. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Yeah, man. So, the text before us gives us several realities that we must look at and that persons devote themselves to. Here, the matter of choice comes up. The theme I choose is very appropriate because every day we make thousands of choices. We choose what to eat, what to wear, what to drink, where to go, how to get there, when to get there. Some decisions are minimal, meaning they are not as significant. And some decisions are life-changing. Life-changing decisions include decisions like who we marry. Yeah, man. Life decisions are big decisions like what type of a career path I choose. These are big issues. But getting up in the morning and saying which color shoes should I wear today is not as significant. It might be an important fashion question or choice, but it isn't a detrimental life-transforming change or choice. Can I say to us that our choices lead to two things? Our choices can either lead to celebration or they can lead to frustration. That we can make choices that make our lives happy and have quality. And we can make choices that cause regret, remorse, sorrow, and grief. Can I say all of us know about them choices? Eh? That we know about choices so we make we feel good. And we're good choices. And we have also made poor, bad choices. And so Jesus raises up the choice between God and money. Then he raises up the choice between God's kingdom and the world. When he does this, he says, life is not about meat and drink and having shelter and food. In the text, he raises up that we worry about those things. But Jesus also presents the matter of faith instead of worrying. So he raises up choosing God versus money, the kingdom of heaven versus the world, and faith versus worrying. Jesus in this text says that those who are focused on earthly issues and earthly matters will end up worrying. They will be worrying, how will those needs be met? How will I satisfy the issues that are happening in my life? Right now you're listening to me and some of you are worrying about how the children them going to eat next week or this week. Some of us are here and we are worrying, how am I going to pay that loan? Some of us are here and we are worrying, how am I going to find a job or get a new job? Some of us are here worrying about how the rent going go because rent due in a few. And so we are worrying about it. Some of us are worrying about the JPS and the NWC bills. Some of us are worrying about the court's bill. And if court's going to come for the stove, the fridge, the appliance that you took out. That you are here and you are concerned about how these things are going. Jesus says that if our focus is earthly, then worry becomes a real reality. But when we are centered on the kingdom of God, we understand that God is fighting for us and that God is working everything out for the good. And so when you are living on the kingdom premise, you understand that you have a God that is fighting for you. Amen. I want to say to us that Jesus says that worry cannot add to your life. But can I say to us that worry can cut it short? Amen. That when we worry, we become physically sick. Amen. That our body breaks down. That when we worry, our lifespan is shortened. Yeah, man, that's what Jesus said. When you worry about the problem, it don't fix it. Worrying takes your energy. Somebody said worrying is like a rocking chair. It goes back and forth, but it takes you nowhere. Can I say to you that worrying is not a part of the solution? It is a part of the problem. Can I say that when you sit and worry, it adds no value to the situation? Well, in fact, it adds value to the situation because it makes the situation bigger than it already is. When you are worrying, you start thinking about how it's going to get worse. It's already bad, you know. So it's as bad and you move it to worst. Yeah, man, that doesn't sound sensible. You can imagine you have a problem in your yard and you struggle and it's bad. And you think about how it's going to get worse. That doesn't help. And so Jesus said, nobody worry. That sounds foolish. Jesus is saying, live carefree because I am caring for you. He must have cast your cares upon me. Because I care for you. Yeah, man. So God have the thing in control. Can I say to us that worrying drains our energy? Worrying steals our joy. Worrying places a heavy burden upon our shoulder. And as I said earlier, it makes us sick. Worry crushes our hope. Worry can dampen our faith. And so we are challenged this morning to put God's kingdom first. Put it before your worldly cares. Put it before the issues that you are dealing with. Put that first, and God says, I will give you everything else. In other words, the solution to the problems that you're facing, the answer to your problems is Jesus. I don't know if I shared this testimony with this group, but when I wasn't a Christian and I was in primary school, thank you, Rev. I was in primary school. I did common entrance. Yeah, man. And so common entrance is multiple choice. You have A, B, C, D, E, and you pick. Now, when we were preparing to do exams, I had a teacher named Miss Benjamin that she would give us math, and who failed would be beaten, would get flogging. We'd stand up outside in the sun, then they get a beaten. And so we had to pass the test. And so we decided that we have to pass every time she give a test, because we not take no lick. And so what we did was, she had us write down 1 to 100, and then we would write A, B, or C, depending on the answer. Now, as we were doing this test, we knew that she would ask us to exchange paper, so me that give Errol my paper. So what I would do is plan with Errol from before the exam. I said, Errol, anyone that I don't know the answer for, I go and put C, and you do the same. And at the end of the exam, we switch paper. So when we switch paper, now and the teacher mark, and so number three, me never know the answer, so I put C. And the teacher said, E. Errol would just take him pencil and put a little mark in at the middle of the C and tick it. The reason we put C was that C was the only letter that had the ability to be turned into the other letters. We could turn the C into a B. We could turn the C into a A. And so the C was our solution. Every time we don't know the answer, put C. Can I say to you, every time you don't know the answer, put Jesus? Some of us, we have been putting relationships as our C. And as we put relationships as our C, we get burned, we get beaten, we get booed. As we put our energy into our C relationship, we realize it now go nowhere and it now work out. Some of us have put our C in partying, but COVID lock off the party and you have a T for go party. And some of the people end up in the back of the truck. Some have selected gambling. Yeah, man, them want broke out of brokenness. And so they will go into cash pattern lotto lines to broke out of brokenness. But my Bible tells me that God will supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. I'm not putting the lotto line over Jesus. Yeah, man, I'm not putting the relationship over Jesus. I'm not putting no rum and drugs and no gun above Jesus. I hear them talk about gun named Gully Jesus. That in the ghetto and the garrison, it is the gun that brings salvation. But gun can fail. Gun can run out of bullet. Gun can get taken away from you. Man can disarm you. Yeah, man. Gun can miss its target. Gun can stick. Police can take away your gun, but they can't take away my Jesus. Oh, some have gone to the Obeyman yard. Yeah, man. Because them have said monkey dip on them back. And devil a fight against them. And so them gone up a Obeyman yard to get a breakthrough. But no power is above the power of the God that we serve. Oh, when you're gone at the Obeyman, you get the blood and him get the meat. Yeah, man. I don't know how that works. Yeah, man, him get the valuable part and you gone home to no dinner. But you want palm read and Obeyman work for deliver you. Yeah, man, with chicken blood and goat blood. You know goat expensive? Can I say to us that if our list is headed up by money, that it is a wrong bang? Can I say to us that if we have multiple sex partners, it is a wrong bang? Can I say that if you're a scammer, an extortionist, that if you are worshipping false God, like what the preacher said earlier, Selassie, that it's a wrong bang? Can I say that if your commitment is to pay PNP and JLP, that it is a wrong bang? You know, when they go to school and then put a little X when they get the thing wrong. Can I say to those who are cheating, those who are married and cheating, it's a wrong bang? That if you are mixed up in homosexuality, it is a wrong bang? that if you're going through gender fluidity, it's a wrong bang. That if you're a gal, it's a gal clown, it is a wrong bang. That if you're a gangster, it is a wrong bang. That if you're a corrupt pastor, politician, lawyer, judge, whatever you are, it's a wrong bang. Wrong up. And so the challenge Jesus raises up is that we cannot serve God and money. We will commit ourselves to one. We can't do both at the same time. Some women will tell you that them love God. And at the same time, them have five different men. One for pay rent, one for buy grocery, one for buy mop stick hairstyle, one for buy clothes, and one for pay the utility bills. Can I say it's not God you love, it's man you love. Your body is the temple. If you love God, your body would be reserved as the temple of God instead of run ramping shop. Yeah, man. Yeah, man. And dolly house. Yeah, and in fact, the new slang today now, women, them are dolly. Yeah, man. But can I say to you that if you're a dolly, you're in folly. You're mixed up in foolishness. Yeah, man. You're a daughter of a king. You're not a dolly. Yeah, you're not like a puppy show figure where people move you around. No, no, God must move you around. Yeah, man. Yeah, man, you have some man about the place. We say them are thugs and gangster. But them are press button. Them can't do nothing in our community unless they done. Tell them. But them tell us that them are the baddest thing on road. I want to say to us that God is challenging us to make a commitment to him. Your loyalty must lie somewhere. I don't know about you, but I know about some people where them call political loyalists. Them devoted to PNP and JLP. Can I say to you, when them people there out there were devoted to them party, that when them party do some stuff when I write, them still stick with them party? That if 10 million go missing, they might say, where the 10 million there? But next week, them still in a them orange shirt, I shout power, and I say, comrade. Oh, some people will be JLP loyalists. And if JLP legalize homosexuality, then burn a fire upon JLP and burn a fire upon Andrew. Oh, but you will see them with them bell ringing election time though. And you will see them in their green shirt because them nah change course. Them nah switch upon them party. Them a go down with the party. Can I say to us that there are some devil loyalists, some people who are loyal to the devil, even though the devil's plan is to kill, to steal, and to destroy, even though the enemy a mash up your life and tear it down. There are some people who have devoted themselves to the kingdom of darkness. Them no want in and a light. Them no want in and a right. Them no want connect themselves to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. They want to mix and mingle with the workers of iniquity and darkness. Oh, but God is looking for some loyalists. Oh, DJ Nicholas, where the God man them there. Where the Matthew, Mark, the Luke, and the John them there. And when he had done the song, he said, where the God woman them there. Yeah, man, we want some Mary and Martha. Yeah, man, we want some Deborah and some Esther. We want some God man and some God woman about the place. Oh, when I go through the Bible, I see a heap of God loyalists. Yeah, man, I see Daniel. Daniel possessed a spirit of excellence, and he prayed 3 times a day. And even when them threatened him with lions then, him never switched upon him God. I see the 3 Hebrew boys. Who devoted themselves to worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and no fiery furnace couldn't cool out their prayers. Oh, I see a King David, who God said is a man after my own heart. Yet David makes some mistake. David mess up, but David stick with God. He was a true worshiper, and him say, I'm going to meditate upon God's word day and night. Oh, I see some Esther. Esther said, I have to see the king. And even if it costs my life, I forgot to check the king. Oh, we want some woman who say, I have to see the king. Some woman and some man about the place, them want to say. Them want to link up with God. God is looking for a remnant church. A faithful few that will stick with him through thick and thin. Some people that will go through the fire and the flood because them put God first. And then put God's kingdom first. Oh, one songwriter say heaven call an election. And we must vote out Satan. Oh, somebody need to vote him out of their lives. Out of their families. Out of your community. Out of your nation. Out of your finances. Out of your health situation. Out of your mental situation. We need to vote out the evil one. Oh, turn to your neighbor and say, vote him out. Yeah, man. We live in a time where corruption, evil, wickedness is on the rise. We live in a society where murders are rampant and where rape and molestations are the order of the day. Oh, we live in a time when the kingdom of darkness is raging and we need some kingdom people, some people who are a part of the family of God. Oh, to become world changers, to step out into your communities and your home and make a difference and represent the cross. Oh, some people have put X beside the bell and some have put X beside the head. But oh, I'm putting X beside the cross because the cross of Jesus is what I choose. Oh, the cross represents the fact that Jesus chose me and you. And when I respond positively to the cross, I am saying I've chosen God. I've selected Christ. Yeah, man. Can I tell you something? God as my president can't get vote out. God as my president. Yeah, man. Him can't get impeached. Yes, God as my president. Him can't get assassinated. Yeah, man. God as my president. Him can't get voted out. God as my president, them can't link him up with no corruption and no scam. God as my president, no hostile takeover can't go on. My God reigns eternally forever. Oh, he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Some call him the King of Glory. Some call him Mighty Counselor. But I call him my Father. Yeah, man, I call him my Savior. I call him my Redeemer. Oh, somebody need to put God first. Yeah, man, as I close off the sermon, I want to challenge you that when you're making your life choices, put God first. Because God says when you put me first, I'm going to work it out for you. So don't waste your life and your time and your energy trying to fix it yourself. Let Jesus fix it for you. He knows just what to do. Yeah, man, turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus knows just what to do. Yeah, man. And so I don't know about you, but I'm sticking with the King of Glory. I'm sticking with the Lord, strong and mighty. Mighty in battle. Oh, lift up your head. Oh, yeah. And the King of Glory shall come in. Somebody need to let in the King of Glory. But if you're going to let in the King of Glory, you're going to have to revisit your list of priorities. You're going to have to look upon your list. And you have to start mark off some things off of the list. Oh, I don't know about you, but it's one thing on my list. And it's Jesus. Because if Jesus is at the top of my list, then my marriage I go all right. If Jesus is on the top of my list, then my finances I go all right. If Jesus is on the top of my list, then my health I go all right. If Jesus is on the top of my list, then I'm not going to lose my mind. Yeah, man, if Jesus is on the top of my list, then the plans that the enemy have for my life now going to work out. Oh, the traps of the enemy and the snares of the fowler and the noisome pestilence and the terror that walketh by day and the destruction that comes by noon and 10,000 shall fall at my side and 10,000 at my right hand. But it shall not come near me because I'm in the secret place of the Most High. I'm abiding under the shadow of the Almighty and God of my back. And because God of my back, me not for worry. Hallelujah. Security forces can't watch my back 24-7. Hawkeye can't watch your property 24-7. But my God never sleeps nor slumber. And so that's why I put him first. I put him first for security. I put him first for health. Yeah, man, because doctors sometimes only can diagnose, but them can't deliver. But my God deliver. The songwriter says, Daniel, God surely shall deliver. That's why I put him first. He's Daniel's God. He's my God. Make sure I'm your God. I want to say to any person who is not a born again believer, you need to put God first. Oh, somebody need to put on the rum buckle. Somebody need to put on the spliff. Somebody need to put on the guns. Somebody need to put on the gang. Oh, and put on and pick up Jesus. Hallelujah. God over devil. Put God first. Jesus. As I wrap up this text, Jesus says that don't worry about food and clothes and drink. Because look upon Solomon. When you read about Solomon, him wealth up. Solomon money big. In fact, I did some recent research on Solomon. And Solomon would have been, I think they said he'd have been a trillionaire in today's world. the amount of assets he had. The man riches. He would have been on the top of the Forbes list. So you see the Forbes list where Rihanna and Chin depend as two Caribbean people, and Jay-Z and them people, Kanye West depend. Solomon would have topped the list. Richer than Elon Musk and Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. Yeah. And God brought him into those riches. But then Jesus said, Solomon in all him glory could even just like a flower's out a door. And he must say, if God clothed the field with grass, when the sun come up, it mash up, it burn it up and destroy it. What am I going to do about you if I'm going to feed bird? When I store and put on nothing, what you are worried about? In other words, Jesus wanted to get us in a mind frame. The mind frame is, listen, man, put God first. Choose God now. Don't put God at the bottom of your to-do list. And I leave, and I close with a challenge to the younger people. The younger people. Sometimes church starts off at the top of your list. When you're young, gonna come up, it's important. But life have a way for trick us, you know. The enemy have a way for trick us. You see, after a while, we're high up in our education, we start stop come church for study. Yeah, man. And then we start substitute church for social time. I say, boy, instead of come church today, I watch a movie, you know. Or instead of come church today, I go hang with friends, you know. And so after a while, social life, school life, career life, all of them, the life, I come before the life that God has given you. And God start drop down the list. In the day one, till him drop a two, till him gone three, till him gone four, till him no more. Yeah, man. And it's a plan of the enemy that he comes in to kill, to steal, and to destroy. Let me tell you something. Some of us, the devil will never start with fornication. That's too blatant and outright. But you know what he will do? He will make us start keep a little malice here and there. Make us start do a little unforgiveness. And only that one person, I unfriend them. Whether socially or in your mind. You unfriend. It's when you unfriend one, it becomes easier. You start unfriend two. And so before you know it, instead of one person, you have malice two, three, four. And as you have malice and a malice, the enemy are working with you in. And before you know it, the malice escalates. And you become really bitter now. like yeast. Good word. Yeah, like how yeast make dough rise. It just rise up in you. And before you know it, you come in like them robot taxi where you carry a bag of people in your heart. And then you just get vile and wicked, and then you don't love nobody, and you start struggling, and your life just get worse. Can I say to us that the enemy is little by little seeking to pull us away from God. Pull us away from putting God first. Putting God, and as we take time and drop God down the list, sometimes we never realize him a drop down the list, you know. And when him come off of the list, you realize your life mess up and mash up. Your life right off and crash. But can I say that even if you're there, there's hope? If you're there, I'm telling the preaching for some teaching. There is hope. Hope is there. And God is calling you this morning. If you're a believer, maybe you backslide, but people don't know that. But you know you backslide. Because sometimes we're at church, but we're backsliding, you know. We still have come church, but we backslide. And we know so we're not right. And also, I want to challenge us that as we live life, we have to be vigilant. The Bible says, walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Redeeming the times because the days are evil. Then him said, wherefore not, don't be unwise and don't know what go on. You must know what go on. That when we look in our society, we must see where go on. We must see that some stuff will happen, that them are legalized some stuff when I write. And so even if it's legal, because it's against God's kingdom policy, we can't embrace it. Because sometimes you get caught up in a religion, you know. And religion leads to ritual. But God is calling us to relationship. Amen. He's calling us to a kingdom. Amen. Where he is the Lord, the sovereign ruler. Yeah, man. And when he is the sovereign ruler of our life, we are living under kingdom benefits and kingdom privileges. Yeah, man. Why you think them have to let out Paul out of prison one at a time in a Rome? After them lock up Paul in a prison, you know. Paul said, I'm a Roman. And they must visit them and say, but we can't lock up Paul a Roman. We don't want Caesar come page with. We have to let him out. And so Paul used his kingdom privileges. He was a Jew born in Rome. So because he was a Roman citizen, he had Roman privileges. And Paul said, I'm going to stop in my Roman privileges right now. Yes. I make them let me out. Yes. Can I say to us, we need to tap in our kingdom privileges? Yes. Oh, gosh. You know, I'm going to close the sermon. But later we'll pick up because I'm going to be sharing later. But I want to say to us, remember that you're a part of God's kingdom. Amen. Put his kingdom first. Amen. Because in God's kingdom, you are priority. So much so that he gave his only begotten son. The cross represents the love God has for me. Can we stand in the presence of the Lord? I'm going to ask the praise team to raise an appropriate song. If you're here and you're not a believer, I don't know, no matter the age, if you're not a born-again believer and you recognize that you need to put God first, that you need to put God at the top of your list before your career path, before your relationships, before any significant decision that you're about to make, that you're going to put God's kingdom first and put God first. The altar is open to such a person. If you're on social media, I'm challenging you to type in the chat, salvation. If you have made a decision that you want to serve the Lord, just type salvation in the chat. Whether you're watching this sermon now live or you'll be watching it delayed. Yeah, man, if you give your heart to the Lord, put that. But there's a second end to this altar call. If you're a Christian and you know that you're struggling to put God first, or some issues are there, and you see a competition, a contest is being forged. Yeah, man, the altar is open for you as well. And you know, I always say people don't respond to these altar calls, Christians, that is. Because we don't want people to one day for backslide, our people to diagnose us. Because if I come up to an altar call like this, I want the people to diagnose me with adultery. One of them might diagnose me with maybe lying, stealing, whatever it is. But you must know, if you want to get closer to your God, and if you want your relationship with your God to be stronger, and if you're here and you desire a stronger relationship with your God, I'm going to ask you to move from where you are as an indication of faith and draw closer to this altar. An altar is a place of sacrifice. Yeah, man. Yes, my brother. Respect. An altar is a place of sacrifice. And we have to make some sacrifices to get to the place that God wants us. Yeah, man. If our walk and our talk going match, if our actions going match up with God's word, we have to make some move. And so, praise him one more time. This morning, don't let pride or fear stop you. If you know this altar call is for you, that you want to do a better job at putting God first, at placing emphasis and priority on Christ, just 30 more seconds and I'm closing this altar call. Move from where you are and join this young man at the altar who has made a great step of faith. Say, listen to me, I want to be better. Yeah, man. Hallelujah. And some of us will say, I'm at the altar, but I'm at the altar in my head. But there is a thing about obedience. Obedience. Because some of us will know we're supposed to be at the altar, you know, but in our minds, we say, yeah, man, I'm up at the altar, but I'm not moving. But stepping to the altar is significant. The altar is critical. Hallelujah. Thank you. I'm going to pray for for these two who have responded to this morning's altar call. And I believe in God for supernatural growth, for supernatural, a spirit of excellence to come upon them and for them to excel in whatever area and aspect of life that they put their hands to in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, I raise up these two that have responded to this morning's altar call, Almighty God. They express a desire to put you first in all things, in all matters, Almighty God. And Father, they are saying that sometimes they may look and it seems as if some competition is coming, some contest is coming, to that decision and choice to put Christ first. But they have stepped to the altar to say that they are not compromising, but that they are going to stand and fight and represent God's kingdom. Father, may your spirit be poured out upon them without measure. I pray for a spirit of excellence. I pray for a spirit of wisdom. I pray for a spirit of discernment. I pray for a spirit of fruitfulness and growth. I pray for a spirit of advancement over them in the name of Jesus. I declare that they are more than conquerors. I declare that they are overcomers. Oh Christ, you have overcome the world and you have placed them in heavenly places right beside you, Almighty God. And so I declare that they too have overcome the world and that they are seated in heavenly places beside Christ Jesus. Father, build a edge. Put a fence around about them, Almighty God. Father, let every plot and plan of the adversary come to naught. Oh, Father, let every intent of the evil one not come to pass, Almighty God. Father, curtail, disrupt, stop every agenda of the adversary. And we declare the will of God. We declare the purpose of God. We declare the power of God. We declare the presence of God over their lives even now, Almighty God. I pray that this young man will be a man of integrity. Oh, that he will be a model and an asset to society. I declare that this young lady, Almighty God, will be a woman of virtue. That she will be a woman of respectability and nobility in the name of Jesus. Father, I declare that they will not be ordinary, but extraordinary. I declare that they will not be weak, but strong. I pray that they will not be without purpose, but have great direction over their lives in the name of Jesus. I declare that they are not victims, but victors. I declare that they are not losers, but winners. I declare that they shall not go under, but over. I declare that they shall win and not lose in the name of Jesus. I declare that they shall walk in the light and in the right. Oh, no matter if it's day or night, they will be people of integrity and respectability. Father, bless them. Let your spirit overshadow them. And Father, we pray for the community. We pray for salvation of souls. We declare that persons will choose Christ and that lives will be transformed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. I hand over to your host, Pastor, to close off.
Bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I choose. Brothers and sisters, friends, the question was asked in heaven, according to the scripture. When God saw the state of the world, he says, who will go? The scripture says, Jesus says, here I am, Father, send me. The song says, he left the splendor of heaven, knowing his destiny. He knew he had to come and die. And he made a profound statement in one of his sermons. He says, if you are ashamed of me before men on earth, when my Father offers a call to you to turn back to him, Jesus says, if you are ashamed of me, if you are ashamed of owning me in this earth, he says, when the day come, when you ask me to own you, I will not be able to qualify you before my Father which is in heaven. Because you have not received what I offer. I can't add to the word. It is already spoken. But I say this as we close. And I ask the praise team to come right now as we do our benediction. I'll say this. Sorry, not benediction. We're going to do our offering and then close. Sorry, my apologies. But I say this, and I want you to hear me very well. Okay? The life you have in this flesh, this earth suit, represents a driver's license. It is your legal rights to transact business in this earth, to walk in this earth, to live in this world. The day that you leave this body, your license are revoked. The Bible says that there is no repentance in the grave. You cannot drive a car dead. Your license are suspended. The day that the breath leave this body, it is in this body you have to make a choice to serve God. Because if you ever allow the devil to trick you out of serving God, making a decision in this body, we are not Roman Catholics. There ain't no Mother Mary taking water to you in no purgatory. Today, if you hear his voice, the scripture says, don't harden your heart. He says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. For the day is coming. If you bypass the opportunity, the day is coming when you will call me. I will not hear you. One of my dread is saying, and I say to my children, just imagine you standing beside the Lord, looking over in the judgment and seeing your mother or I saying, you don't know me, I'm your father. But the Bible says God shall wipe away our tear, our memory, all the history gone. And no matter who is on the other side, I don't know you. So when this Bible speaks of today, if you hear his voice, you make a decision for your well-being, for your eternal soul. Because at the end of the day, the question is asked, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? The preacher said we are doing some things instead of God. And every time we try something, we remove God from above the list to on the list. Then he moved from number one to two. And he keeps on going down the list till he can't find him anymore. But I say to you, the God we preach is a God of love that wants to redeem you. And it doesn't matter what you have done or where you have gone, he will find you. He is always searching out your good. We offer this saving God to you this morning. I want to contemplate and make a decision to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you. As our praise team come and we do our day's collection of tithes and offering, God bless you.
We're going to sing as we collect the offering. Can I ask you to stand and sing with us as you collect our day's tithe and offering? Daniel's God
surely will deliver. Daniel's God surely will deliver. If you only look to him by faith, Daniel's God surely will deliver. Yeah.
before you this morning to give you thanks. We thank you for all that your people have given, and you ask that you will bless it so that it can go towards the building of your kingdom. We ask that you will cleanse each and every one of us. Bless those who didn't give and those who did. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Remember just to join us this evening. Join us this evening at 6 p.m. as we continue our weekend of meetings. God bless you. Thank you for staying with us. Praise team, can you take us out with our benediction?